Good day, everybody. I think this is a wonderful opportunity for us to have a look at some of the photographs that my students sent me and asked me to comment on it. So let's start off with this photograph from my student Karen Kotze. This is a very nice photograph. What I like about it is the simplicity of the image. Firstly, a soft palette of colors with the light blue and the yellowish colors contrasting each other. Also, the soft background and the detailed of the neck of the violin is also creating a nice contrast. So this is a nice image. Also, the flowers in it gives it a bit of life. When we look at the image and we enlarge it a bit, let's see what we can see on this one. And we can see down here in this areas, there is some color fringing around the strings of the violin. And that is immediately a problem on an image that we need to take away with Photoshop. Something else that is very noticeable when we look at the enlargement here is the visible noise on the image. It makes the image very soft. You can see here, although this should be very sharp in focus on the edges of the violin, it is not 100% sharp. Looking at the image a little bit more scaled down, it appears very, very sharp. However, it is not contrasted enough, it is not sharp enough. I would have changed here is not to have the strings facing nearly straight through the image, but rather to one corner of the image. Perhaps if we had the strings from the bottom right corner to the top left corner, that would have been a nice impact. Or on the bottom left and this head on the top right, that would have drawn the eyes back into the image. Two things that is a little bit bothering me on this image is these areas on the side. I'm not 100% sure what it is. And also the material in front that is obscuring the front edge of the violin. That is little cosmetic changes I would do. But overall, I like the image. I like the mood that it portrays for us. Okay, let's look at the other image. Food photography is a very interesting field, and I like it very much. Well, first of all, I like food photography, and secondly, obviously, I like the food. And especially if there's a lot of cheese and crackers involved in it with the fruit. Man, that is my way of saying I am there. When we take photographs of the food, there are various ways of looking at the image. We can see the image from straight above. We can see it from in front. In other words, straight looking onto the thing like a burger, and we can see the layers on the burger. Or at the different angles that we look at it. So normally it is at a 45 degree angle. Natural light is a bonus factor to have in an image like this, because it is a nice soft diffused light and it creates nice texture with all the elements. The arrangement of elements is very nice. However, I feel this image is a little bit busy. Because the cheese that's yellow in color and the cheese that's white in color is competing against each other. Another aspect to consider is the depth of field. Do you want everything in focus? Or do you just want a specific area that is in focus to draw the attention to the viewer? So in this case, it is to the front part of the image and mostly the yellow piece of cheese in front. So because that area is a little bit out of focus, we tend to look away from it and look at the areas that is in focus. Overall, not a bad photograph to have. Lighting is very nice. Color is good. Composition is not bad. I would have liked to see a little bit more shadows on the one side of the image. Perhaps if we put the black card or board on this side, then we can look at it and see that it will absorb all the colors. Here is an image taken by student Chris, and it just shows you that even though you use a cell phone in the evening, you can still get a very impressive image. Obviously, there's a lot of opportunities here that you can overcome with a normal camera, but not with a cell phone. So let's look at the basic items here. First of all, if we look at the image, we zoom in a little bit, we can see there is some movement in the trees. So I assume that the wind was blowing, and that is great to have. However, if we look at the focus of the image, we can see that the image is not perfectly in focus. Something else is the light contrast. Although it is exposed for this area of the house and the trees, there's an area that is lit with normal light, and that area is overexposed and washed out. Details are lost in this area here. So that is a problem if you don't have a very high dynamic range on your camera. And cell phones do have the tendency not to have that high dynamic range that we need from a normal camera. Another mistake that we make in evening is to look at the image, but we forget about the shadow that we cast. You can obviously see that this is a person standing over here and creates a shadow that's overpowered by this light source over there. As a matter of fact, for my liking, this shadow is a bit distracting. And there was light from behind the photographer. But for a cell phone photograph, I think he did very well with this image to capture the light and get the exposure right. A few seconds later, he took another photograph, the same area, and he correctly exposed for this area here, and that means that he underexposed the rest of the image. Well, let's have a look at the exposed area, and I like it. The exposure is very nice, it's moody, it is quite a nice image to have. However, he took the photograph also in the portrait mode. The only reason I would take a photograph like this in portrait mode is to do a HDR merge on the image. So you get that Albany shot, or the best of both worlds for it. Other than that, this area here at the bottom is dead space. It is lost. There's no detail in it. There's no reason for it. There's no purpose in this area. And that is distracting for the photograph. So what we can do is we can perhaps do a bit of cropping here and see how it works if we do some cropping. Okay, and just zoom in a little bit. And just for a starter, I think this cropping is working much, much better. You have the lead in line taking you all the way to the main focus of the image here. You can even crop it a little bit more for the rule of thirds, but let's just see if that will work better. And obviously it works wonderful. The lead in line, the rule of thirds, the main focus, house number, everything there. I think it works very, very well. So cropping is very important for this image. Now just look at this image here. What a scene. What a tremendous place to be. I just love it. But landscapes are a little bit more tricky than we think. First of all, we need a central point of focus. And in many cases, the whole scene is the point of focus. And that is a problem, because there is no central point of interest and your eye jumps all over the show. What we could have done on this one is to focus more on this area of the mountain, perhaps, or another area of the mountains. Zoom in a little bit. But it is difficult. Sometimes it's just one of those shots that there is no specific point that jumps out and says, take me, I'm the most important area in this image. The whole image is just beauty. It's tranquil. It is absolutely a pleasure to be there and enjoy it. Things to look at for this is, if we say it is nature photography, this image will be disqualified because of the human elements, the fences in the image. If we say it is landscape, it will fall into the correct category. You do have a foreground area, you have a middle ground area, and you have the background area. Sometimes we can say this part is the foreground, that part is the middle ground, and that part is the background. Depends on who is looking at the photograph. What would I have changed in this image? Well, firstly, there is not much significance in the sky. There's nothing specific in the sky that draws my attention. So that is, to me, a bit of a dead area or dead space. If we would like to crop the image, let's just see what happens if we crop it as a panoramic image to this effect. Immediately, less sky and a beautiful area to look at. I think different cropping will result in a better image in this case. But let's look at the original image again. The mood is very subtle, and the aerial perspective with the blue mountains tells us that this is close to us and that is much further away from us, and the landscape goes on into the distance. There's quite a few opportunities and focal points in this image that we can concentrate on. Something else to remember is to set your camera on a tripod and level the camera out to be 100% level when you take this photograph. That will ensure that if the camera is level, the horizon view of the mountains and stuff would be more correct. Yes, sometimes the mountain range can slope off to one side, but in many instances, if you just do a handheld shoot of this area, it is easy to misjudge the sloping of the mountains, and the horizon view can be slightly skew. So we need to straighten the horizon line for that. But if we are not there and we do not know this area very well, it is impossible to say if the mountain range is sloping or the camera was all skew. Another thing is we can also crop the image in such a way that there is no sky and no fence in the image, and just look at the different atmosphere and mood created with this image. Now all this light blue and distant mountains, the majestic mountains, is pushing your eye into this foreground area and focusing your eye on the little area in front of you. Let's have a look at the other photograph that Kobus has sent in for us. The Namib Desert. What a place, what a pleasure. There are so many opportunities to take exquisite photographs. Yes, there are areas that is restricted from entering and exiting at certain times, especially in Sossusvlei and the salt pans there. You need special permission to stay longer or to enter it sooner in the morning. But I'm sure if you negotiate with the people there in the parks, they will make an arrangement for you. I love the simplicity of the colors, the monotonous toning of the colors, brown. So, some people may see this as a color image. Other people can see this as a monochrome image. However, that little corner there, it's not part of the mountain, splits it into a color image. If that little corner was also filled with the mountainside, the sand dune, it would have been exquisite photograph. Now it's obviously important to look at where we place the main focal point, and this was placed right in the center. Unfortunately, it is not breaking the rules, and it would have looked much better on a rule of thirds. this was placed either on one of the rule of third points, it would have enhanced the image much, much more. Another thing to remember is color contrast. See the nice colors, dark, it draws your attention. However, this little area over there also draws my attention. So it is a little bit distracting, but if you look at enhancing this image, let's just see if we can see what I'm talking about. And we put it right over there, and look at that fantastic image, just a little bit of cropping. Now, first of all, people would say, that is the way to photograph the image from the start. Well, not necessarily. There's another term that says shoot to crop. And that is referring to the aspect of I can put it in the middle and in post-production I can crop it to the rule of thirds for that portion. Or I can crop it to be on that portion. I can even crop it this way. Just bring this one a little bit in. I can do it that way around. You can do it this way around. So now there's already four images. Or I can place it dead center, the longer shot. So I've got five images from this one image, just by giving it enough space around it and say, I am willing to crop it afterwards. Just look at that image there. Beautiful. Although it's now centrally placed, that little darker section there falls on the rule of fifths and also enhances the image. Nice foreground, middle ground, and the background. Stunning photograph, exposure wise on this photograph, amazing. I just wish I was there with this photographer to enjoy what he enjoyed. One day I will still go to the Namib and take some photographs there. I think it is a great place to take photographs. Still life is one of my favorite subjects to do. I can spend lots of time setting up the scene until I'm satisfied with the image that I want, the composition is right, the lighting set up correctly, and then I can take the photograph. This image is not bad at all. Yes, there are a few aspects that I could improve on. But my student, Louise, has done a very nice job here of arranging and scattering the fruit and letting it fall out of the little tin. Also, I like the vignetting around the side, drawing focus to the area in the center. Although this image breaks the rule by being right in the center, I think it is working for this. Although there are some dead space around it that could have been utilized better. Perhaps if we did a different crop on this image, let's see what happens if we do that. Cut it over there and it's a tighter crop, but not bad still. Although, the flowers that's out of focus here is a little bit distracting to me. It's too much out of focus. It is difficult to shoot at a certain angle for a still life and get everything in focus plus have the background out of focus. To do that, you need to use a long focal length lens, something like a 300 millimeter lens or longer. Stand further away and then just crop in, zoom in with a aperture of f16 or so to get it done. Looking at this image, I think there's another problem on this. Okay, we can't see everything because of the resolution. But I'm satisfied that the noise on this image is very low. So the only problem I would say at this point of time would be that the focus is out and there's some slight overexposure on the flowers and the leaf in this area. I would assume that the photographer used on-camera flash to take this photograph. It might have worked if she used a flash off-camera from the side, or just use natural lighting, a window light with a reflector on the other side to fill in some light and use that as the main light source and not on-camera flash. Looking at the last image that Louis sent us, there's very nice separation between the background, foreground and the middle ground where the hoopoe is. This is a nice image. However, things that needs improvement on this image is get rid of the head space all around the bird, not placing the bird in the center, but rather on a rule of thirds. So different cropping will work. Draws the bird's attention with a click sound or something, so the bird would look into a certain direction and we can see perhaps some reflection of the sun in the eye of the bird. I will post some of my images to show what I'm talking about for this type of work. Overall, it's nice to see a photograph of this bird, but there's no catch light on the bird's eyes. So we say it is the eyes are dead, and that's not a good feature to have.
Good and happy people, please show us your appreciation and click on the like button and the dislike button. Also remember to click on the subscribe button at the bottom right corner. And please leave a comment so we know what to do for the future for you as well. Thank you.
So let's have a look at some of my photographs. Here is one of my attempts for food photography. As you can see, side lighting, but not from behind, which would have given a better effect if it would have been from behind. Here's another shot of food photography, just to show you that you don't need to go wide all the time. You can zoom in. Okay, this one is just to show you that you don't necessarily have to take it in landscape mode, but in portrait mode it can also work. Nature photography. You can see that I've silhouetted the foreground because the emphasis is on the clouds. Also, the tree is on the rule of thirds. Here is another shot of nature, but also too much sky in the image. However, I did shoot this one to crop, so I can crop out this section here, or I can crop out this section there. So that's one of the great things to remember, but I can't present this as the final image. Food photography. This is the front view. This one had a lot of work on it because I used a black background and I used some filters to filter out all the reflections and use light from different angles, but to my liking it's too much light from the front, so there's not much definition in the burger. This one looks a little bit better. Side lighting and some reflection from the right side as well. Although, if I had a half a stop or more less light from the right hand side, it would have created more depth in the image. Also, I need to look at those little blunders over there. This was still when we were busy setting up. You can see the severe reflections of the light coming from behind. However, the lighting is very adequate for this image to show the texture of the image. So if we just would crop it a little bit, it already looks much, much better. Here is another approach for landscape. You can use the foreground as your main attraction to separate the background and the distance. This is a very nice example of backlighting giving us a problem in nature photography. Well, if we would just enhance the image, and we say just the lighting, some full flash, make it lighter until we have the light that we want on the bird. Much better. However, now the background is too much overexposed. The bird is still a little bit underexposed. Well, in that case, great idea is to use some flash. Fill in flash on your subject. Another example of food photography. See the background slightly out of focus, but the main subject is in focus. See all the detail on the tomatoes. Well, that's it for now. Let's see what comments you have about the photographs. You are very welcome to comment in the comment section on all of these photographs and tell me what your view of them, where you would like to see being handled differently. You are very welcome to send your images to me for comments and discussions on the image. My email address is in the information section of this YouTube video at the bottom.